Welcome back. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Liz Svatek, the original warrior woman. She has been leading warrior women to greatness for 8 years. She's the founder of Warrior Women, an online community of over 65,000 women who encourage each other to put themselves back on the list. Liz is an in-demand worldwide speaker, and she hosts the top-rated Conversations with Warrior Women with Liz Svatek podcast that airs on Apple, Spotify, and Google Play. As a coach, Liz works with women across the country, inspiring them to access their inner warrior, leap for greatness personally and professionally. Liz, it is such a pleasure to have you today. We're so excited to have this conversation about who warrior women are and how do we become them?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, you guys are warrior women. So I'm just glad to be here with you. Yeah, feel it. Yes. So thank you so much for having me on today.
Oh, it is such a pleasure. Well, let's start off by saying, you know, tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you get this Warrior Women group started?
Well, you know what? I wish I could say it came from all the unicorns and rainbows that were just flying by me, but really it was born out of having a son was born with some issues. He has a physical difference in his right arm. It's right arterial thrombosis, which basically means he had a bunch of blood clots in his right arm. And after going through infertility and in vitro, I kind of thought, okay, my problems are over. Now I'm just going to sail through the rest of my life and it's going to be magical. That was not the plan. My son had to spend 52 days in the hospital. He almost died. He had a stroke. It was unbelievable. So I say that to say that boy is now turning 15 and has his arm, he's not brain damaged. He's doing wonderfully. But that was a tough thing to be in the hospital for 52 days, to go home without a baby and to endure that. So in that time, I noticed that women, when I told women that my friends, I was in the hospital, that's when they started telling me, oh, I was too. My kid had jaundice. My kid had a heart thing and we had to stay for 2 weeks. Hello? No one had ever said anything. And I thought, oh my gosh, if we don't tell each other the truth, if we don't reveal ourselves, how can we heal? How can we heal if we don't reveal? So I thought, I really need to encourage women to just tell their warrior stories and to know that that is okay. There's no shame in being in the hospital with your kid after they're born. There's no shame. So I wanted to kind of highlight, you know, women, their stories, how resilient they are, and bring us together.
Oh, I love this. And I think it's so important. And I'm glad to see that there is more light being shed on this in the media and in the news lately. Tell us a little bit about, like, who is a warrior woman?
Well, I mean, I told you this before, but all women are warriors. We are not born warriors, of course, because we're just babies. We're little kids, but we become warriors. And that is over time. All of us have been on the floor. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows what I mean when I say that. On the floor, you don't think you can get back up. You don't know what you're going to do. Every one of us has been through that. And I think sometimes as we get older and we have more challenges, we think things are going to get easier, but really there's just more challenges. Just when we get older, we just have to get better at handling them. But I think we forget sometimes that we can do hard things. So I want women to know that they are warriors just by being women and what they've been through, you know, in their lives.
Yeah, I love that. And, you know, sometimes I've noticed for me, you know, I grew up trying to be a pleaser, make everyone happy. And I still have that in me. But, you know, sometimes when there's something that's worth fighting for, that's when you really discover that inner warrior. And for me, that happened with my first child as well, who had some physical problems and was in the hospital. And, you know, it took several years for me to figure out what was going on. And you realize that you're willing to do anything for that kid. Anything. You're willing to yell at any doctor. You're willing to go to any lengths. You will do anything it takes because you love something more than you fear upsetting the apple cart. Right.
Absolutely.
And so it kind of makes me a little emotional thinking about it right now, because it is really hard to do. And it is hard to, you know, assert yourself, but I feel like you're really empowering people to be able to do it and that it gets easier over time.
Well, I also want to say that another thing that I had a big problem with was asking for help. Mm-hmm. I didn't want anyone to pity me. I didn't want to feel that. And I felt ashamed. Mm-hmm. And it was only when I started accepting the help that people wanted to bring me dinner and help and show up. And I'm still learning that. Mm-hmm. You know, I still have things go on and people want to show up for me. And I have to remember, it's not just about me showing up for other people, because I want to show up for everyone.
Yeah.
I want to bring you dinner. But if I want to bring you dinner, I have to accept when you want to do it for me.
Mm-hmm.
You have to really check in with your receivership, because really how abundant you are is based on how much you can receive. And that sounds crazy, but it is really true.
Well, Lauren brought up a really good topic before we jumped on this call today or on our, and she said, you know, how do we reinvent ourselves? How do we remember that we're warrior women? Lauren, you phrased that more eloquently than I did, but.
And I'm also a little bit beyond you guys in terms of years, yet you're really presenting it as we focused and it came to us as mothers, right? When you became a mother. So as a dog mom, I didn't have those issues, but living birth was not my problem. That would have been interesting. But at the same time, I'm listening to you and thinking, okay, in the early years, I mean, like you, Amy, I was raised to be a good girl, to be a nice girl, to be a pleaser. I was put in my family to make everybody happy. Mm-hmm. And I know that. So how does that then translate to getting yourself a seat at the corporate table? How does that translate to negotiating a lease contract? How does that open you to all the things that you don't know how to do? Yet, you know, if you really said to yourself, if I knew how to do this, what would I do? Mm-hmm. And then move forward. And I think that is really the core of Liz's conversation, is you know what to do. You need to ask the questions. And something I learned from another previous guest we had on the show years ago was Andrea Quinn, who is a life coach, amazing woman, who always talks about the feminine power in taking that breath in, and that breath allows you to receive, and then your output is creation. Mm-hmm. And that's what you're saying. As mothers, you took the breath in and you created those little babies. So that was your job. Mm-hmm. And that's what you knew how to do, even though you didn't know how to do it. Yeah. So what else do we breathe in and then create? Because we're not supposed to be the doers. Mm-hmm. The guys are the doers, but we're left to do. So mm-hmm. how do we invent ourselves on both sides?
And I also think reinvention is a funny word, because I think people think you just have one reinvention. No, you are reinventing. ING, almost your whole life. You know, I mean, you can think back to your 20s, your 30s, your 40s. I'm in my 50s now. You know, you can really think about those time periods and think, wow, I needed to reinvent this. Sometimes that takes the form of a friendship, letting mm-hmm. a friendship go, making a space for another friend. Sometimes that's a divorce. Sometimes that's a job change. You know, people, I think the misnomer is that it is a midlife crisis. I think mm-hmm. it's a cry for reinvention. You don't need necessarily to have, you're not in crisis necessarily. It's more that you just need to kind of evaluate and say, wait a minute, just because I'm good at something. For example, I had a social media agency for 10 years. Mm-hmm. We had top clients. I was doing every celebrity's social media. Well, guess what? I don't want to do that anymore. Mm-hmm. Just because I'm good at it and I was well paid doesn't mean I have to do that anymore. And when I let myself let that go, when I gave myself permission to reinvent, I was never happier. And now I've grown exponentially. But you have to be willing to say, just because I'm good at something, do I have to keep doing it for the rest of my life? No, no, you don't.
Oh, I love that. I needed to hear that today too, actually.
I love it. And interestingly, just recently, a friend said to me, you know, every time you are poised for a new trajectory, you have like a health breakdown. Like you have to take yourself to bed for a day or 10, or you have to just totally shut yourself off and redirect. She said, we all know when you're ready to birth something new. You're the only one who doesn't know.
It's so true, though.
Interesting. And I love the way that we're talking about reinvention with creation. That is a really significant and very positive way of reframing what, like you were saying, Liz, quote unquote, midlife crisis or some kind of a crisis. And it doesn't need to be negative. It's a positive change. It's a, you know,
can be a rebirth,
growth opportunity. Yep. That's right. So how do we know if we're kind of stagnating we haven't really accessed our inner warrior? Like, what are some signs of that?
Well, I hate to say it, but you'll know because you're watering dead plants.
Yeah.
And people love when I say this and they're like, what are you talking about, Liz? I actually brought a dead plant to my last speaking gig because I wanted women to really understand what I was talking about. But when I say that, I mean, some people are pouring into work, pouring into their families, pouring into a relationship that is not working. You are giving so much that it's killing you. What does that look like? I say, how are you? Where would you like to go? We're going to have coffee. Where do you want to go? I don't know. Mm-hmm. You have no opinion left. You don't even know what kind of ice cream you like anymore. You feel confused all the time. Foggy brain.
Mm-hmm.
So things like that, it's subtle forms. But when you kind of are out of touch with yourself, you'll just be exhausted all the time. You feel like your to-do list is choking you. I cannot tell you how many women are trading their worth for a to-do list.
Mm.
That is, to me, the sign that you need a reinvention. If you look at your calendar and there's nothing you like on there, that's a problem, right? Mm-hmm. You have to look at that. And I think when you do look at it, first you have to kind of breathe and calm, you know, say, it's okay. These things are going on. But once you kind of, if you kind of get a bird's eye view on it, if you can pull yourself out, almost like kind of, you know, pulling back like on a camera, right? And looking down, maybe in fact, going in your little glass elevator and going to the 29th floor versus being on the third floor, like third to second floor views of things are horrible, by the way. Mm-hmm. That's like basement level thinking, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes we have to go up to the 29th floor and look down and say, my kid just failed that math test. I think it's going to be okay. He'll go to college. Yeah. I'm not going to lose my mind today. You know, I mean, it sounds funny, but we get really caught up in our day to day. Sometimes you got to zoom out. Right?
That's so, so true. Well, I remember having, you know, I actually had kind of like a mind shift this past weekend because we were doing some home remodeling, and my husband has been so great and has been handling a lot of it. But the main contractor has been speaking almost exclusively to him. And I've had a hard time getting his mind share and to have him, you know, tell me what's going on. So finally, I was just getting more and more and more upset about everything. And I'm noticing all these things that are going wrong. He's nowhere to be found. And so I was like, you know what? This is my response. If I'm upset, it's my responsibility to do something about this. And so I called a meeting and I said, I was very direct, which is another issue that people don't expect women to be direct. And so then they get all offended, but really it's just direct. It's not rude, right? And I said, I would like more communication from you. This is how I would like the communication. I would like it in an email each week. I would like you to tell me what you're going to be doing.
I love this. That's called clarity.
Yeah. And so, you know, and so he calls my husband and he goes, oh, Amy's really upset. And Jeff's like, Jeff, to his credit, is one of the most like truly egalitarian men, which is why he and I get along really well. And he said, I think she needs more communication from you, which was exactly what I needed. So then we had our meeting. My anxiety level just went way down, but instead of getting upset, like I was upset, but I had to realize, like, I had to harness my warrior from within and take my own responsibility to change what was going on, rather, because I had tried other ways and it didn't work. So finally I was like, I don't care if they think I'm a bitch. This is what's going to happen in order for me to feel better.
Well, and have you also noticed though, that we create stories?
Mm-hmm.
This is what fascinates me the most, because that's the most perfect story in the world. First of all, you could have not said a word.
Mm-hmm.
You could have just let it kind of keep going, get madder and madder. And then here comes the stories. You know what? They're treating me like that because I'm a woman. They're not, they don't respect me. You know what? Now I'm going to be mad at my husband too, because I feel like he's getting in the way of everything that's going on and he's not even letting me in. He doesn't want me to talk either. That's when all these stories happen. Mm-hmm. you know, and that is just stuff we're making up in our heads, by the way, that's coming from nowhere. It's just coming from our fears or ego or past experience or wherever it's, but it's made up really. It doesn't really mean anything. So the fact that you took control of that and said, you know, I'm going to take care of myself. I really need this man to communicate with me so I feel like I know what's happening.
And I love that you said that too, because I did start feeling angrier and I did start getting mad at my husband and I did start like all those things that you just said, I experienced all of it. And finally I was like, it's actually not their fault. I need action. And this is what I actually took the time to ask for it. And so I don't think I could have done that 20 years ago. And so I think that the way that you're training people to help, you know, to really harness their inner warrior is so needed. And it is the accountability that we need as women to be able to really change the world, because I think we have it in us to really do that, to really change the world for the better.
I agree. And I think, you know, the old paradigm of the man's coming to save you. I hate to tell everyone, women, listen to me. No one's coming to save you. The only person who's coming to save you is you. Mm-hmm. And when you think about that, you don't have to be upset about that or feel not safe or anything. You just know, oh, I have to use my voice. Because no one's a mind reader. My husband has no idea what I want for Christmas. Mm-hmm. No clue. I've been married 18 years. Should he know? I don't really care. He does not know. I'm not going to create a fight with my husband about Christmas gifts, right? Yeah. Like, who cares? Yeah. I'm going to say, hey, here's some things I kind of want, or I don't really want that many gifts this year. You know what? I'm not really feeling like I want anything. I feel like we're spending money in the house. Communication.
It's so important. It's so important. And Lauren, I love that you know, Liz and I are both living a like more traditional life with married with children, right? But you bring a really important point that, you know, this applies to all women everywhere. All women are warriors. And no matter the age, no matter the gender, no matter the stage of life. And I think that like you guys are saying, like that clear communication and feeling entitled to speak your voice is so important. And I love that you're giving women that, they're empowering them to feel entitled to speaking their voice, which I think is something that we really struggle with. I don't know, Lauren, what are your thoughts? You've been pretty quiet on this.
This is a giant topic. I feel like we could go on like this for hours. And of course, I think Liz has an amazing perspective on it. And I think what's really showing up for me is that we're all living this. This is not you or them. This is every single one of us at some time has been put aside or has felt put aside and had to struggle with how do I put myself back on the list? How do I put myself at the table? Mm-hmm. And I think it's hard sometimes to find someone to talk to about how to do that, but we have to ask for help and we have to be willing to reach out knowing that we don't have an answer, which we're accustomed to having. Mm-hmm. And the best thing we can do is tap our girlfriends, because that's what we do best. We really, when we set our minds to it and we allow for holding space for someone else, we also have been through it, right? I know my experience is my experience, but guess what? Sometimes Amy is having a similar experience that I maybe had 5 years ago, and I can recognize it for her and we can accelerate her process.
It's so true. It's so true. You know what? I always love to say when I hear another woman tell her story, I hear mine. Mm-hmm. Because we may not have the exact same life, but there are parts of another woman's story I always resonate with. Mm-hmm. Like, oh my gosh, I've been afraid like that. I've been afraid to use my voice. Oh my gosh, I had an employer treat me like that. And I had to really like check myself and ask myself, do I really want this job or whatever it is? Or I've had that insecurity. That's the way women really do connect. It's that if you are willing to talk about all the things that are going on with you and be real and sometimes raw and just tell the truth, another woman will hold space for you. That's the beauty of women. You know, we're not over here trying to act like we're great all the time. When another woman tells you something's going on and reveals herself, that's when you know you're really going to connect.
Mm-hmm. I think that's really an important point is we're so used to at this point, oh my goodness, and you know better than anyone having run a social media agency. But, you know, social media shows us this beautiful front garden all the time. It never shows us the burning inside of the house. And so I feel like the opportunity here in a community of supportive, like-minded women is something that should exist everywhere. I mean, there's no way one community can reach everyone, but oh my gosh, there need to be pockets of this that every woman can access. Liz, how do we make that happen?
Well, you know, I started my mastermind groups sort of for this reason. Of course, I coach women. I do group coaching. I individually coach. I have my podcast. I get to talk to women. I love that. But I started these masterminds, which is just these small groups of women. And I bring women together because I really believe in the power of other women meeting new women that they don't know and talking about what's going on. Because what ends up happening is, first of all, that woman's story, like we just said, is your own story. Mm-hmm. But secondly, it's nice to hear from somebody who their only thought is, I only care about you, Lauren. I don't really care about like your friend or, you know, your whatever. I just am here for you, Lauren. And I hear you saying that you're not happy. So let me just be here for you, hold the space and say, what's next for you? What can you change? What should be different? And when I see these women come together, one of the first meetings that we ever had with a mastermind group, it was so crazy because I said, why did you give yourself the gift of this time? And they all said, because I give myself nothing, nothing. And it broke my heart because we give and give and give to everything. We put anything in front of ourselves. So putting yourself back on the list, I mean, I don't even care about that anymore. I'm like, put yourself at the top. Can we just put ourselves at the top, Lauren? I mean, that's what I want. I want to be up there, Amy, at the top.
And even for a minute.
Well, you know, you bring up another great point that, you know, if we don't have anything left in ourselves to give, then we're not very good givers. And so there's that give and take where we find fulfillment and joy in serving. We find, you know, support from others who are doing that for us. And if we can esteem ourselves, even equal with everyone else, you know, then our bucket starts getting filled again. And then we have more and more to give.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I think that's when we get to take a real deep breath and fill ourselves and feel it. I think that's really the key. So Liz, how does everybody find you? Because I really, really believe everybody needs to find you.
You guys are amazing. Well, I have my Conversations with Warrior Women podcast. You can absolutely listen to that. And I am Warrior Women Pod or Liz.Svatek on Instagram. And you can go to LizSvatek.com if you want to join my mastermind or if you want to work with me coaching. I mean, I love all the women I get to meet. So I would love to meet any new women who want to connect with me.
Perfect. We will put that information both on the screen and on the blog that goes along with the recording. Thank you. Thank you. We will have to continue this conversation, but we're so grateful that you came to visit with us today.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
And we'll be right back.